Today's Thursday, so I just wanted to, for my own safety reasons, document online what's been going on. I've called law enforcement 3 times. I've posted proof and a screenshot of that. I also have multiple witnesses who were at the scene where I was assaulted. Xavier decided to pick a fight, much like he did the weekend of NASCAR weekend, where he dragged me down the street without warning by my wrist in front of law enforcement. So law enforcement cars are parked less than a block away with lights on, and they do nothing to intervene. Out of nowhere, out of character, I went to buy both of us something to eat at 7-Eleven. And while we were there, he was overtly disrespectful, incredibly disrespectful. For anyone who's been watching this entire time, Xavier entered my life saying that his brother was the district attorney for the state of Illinois, and he knew the situation that had been playing out with me, with Dylan Smith, Y12173, among others. So he came to me claiming to be the district attorney, and saying that he had a safe place for me to go after I was raped, beaten, bludgeoned, stabbed 11 times by 3 women with screwdrivers, separated from my 3 minor children, raped and impregnated with twins, and raped and impregnated a second time just with 1 baby. Genitalia mutilated while I was asleep, woke up screaming out in pain at MD Bull's Airbnb when my cervix was stretched open intentionally. All of this has been reported to the police in both writing as well as in person as well as over the phone. They continue to do absolutely nothing to intervene. I'm now 5 months pregnant, taking an iron pill and prenatal vitamin. That's the only medication that I take. Which is empty, needs a refill, because I am a good mom and I do care. Following throwing the coffee in my face and me calling law enforcement asking for them to please apprehend him or get him to leave, they never showed up. He continued to follow me until I literally just couldn't keep going anymore. I'm pregnant, I'm exhausted, and I needed to lay down. I found a quiet spot, a spot that I have historically been able to rest in without being fucked with or abused, and I went to sleep. So he assaulted me for 3 or 4 hours verbally, literally falling behind me, calling me every name in the book, and it's all sexually related. So he hones in on the fact that I have a history of being raped and a severe history with sexual trauma. And then he exploits that publicly, very loudly. And this is all new. Previous to this, it's only been physical abuse, so, and only financial as well. So he throws a cup of coffee in my face after 3 hours of being belligerent. The whole day he was fabulous, he was kind, he was nice, there were no issues. Like I said, like a light switch, switches to complete and total belligerence, is overtly disrespectful. Awful to be around. I didn't ask him for anything. I didn't ask him to pay me back the thousands of dollars that he owes me. I didn't ask him, you know, to borrow me anything or to protect me. He approached my life claiming that the district attorney's office was involved and that it was his job to, quote, keep me safe and prevent me from being raped and murdered again. That was 14 months ago, and still nothing has been done. I've personally been to the state's attorney's office about 20 times. I've been to all jurisdictions of Chicago law enforcement. I've been to Barrington Police, Lake County, Cook County, DuPage County. And none of these law enforcement agencies have done anything to help me. In addition, the state's attorney's office seems as though it's been taken over. When you go there's a big, huge lady sitting at the front door. That physically won't let you by. She will not let you speak with the state's attorney. I also have her on camera. So, again, my original fears that the government locally at least have been taken over by gangs, by violence, by I really don't know what, feel like they're true. Following the coffee being thrown on my face last night, which I still haven't been able to wash off, by the way, and into my hair, and all over my last clean outfit, I just gave up and went to sleep around 3 o'clock in the morning to approximately early 30s black light-skinned men with athletic apparel, jeans and a hoodie, and gym shoes, attempted to open the padlock where on my tent. Xavier was supposed to be sleeping right outside the door. I did nothing to intervene. I said, "This is my tent, what are you doing?" They said, "Open the fucking door, bitch. We're looking for someone." I said, "They're not in here." I tried to grab the padlock. They ripped the entire wall and door from the floor and then proceeded to kick me in my face. I'm 5 months pregnant again, as you all know. So while I was asleep, after being assaulted with the coffee, calling law enforcement for help, asking him to leave and him refusing, I was then permitted about 4 hours of sleep before I was physically attacked by two light-skinned black men with a New York accent. Again, I was dragged about 4 to 6 feet by the tent. I was sleeping just in there with my yoga mat and a blanket. They ripped the entire wall off and kicked me in my head right here, once or twice. I was crying, screaming for help. After about 2 to 3 minutes of struggling, just holding my belly and being in the fetal position, trying to make sure that they didn't kick my baby, that's when I finally heard Xavier say, "She's pregnant, she doesn't have anything." And they were already like disengaged at that time. He didn't ask me, "Are you okay?" He didn't ask me, "Do you want to go to the hospital?" He walked 5 feet away to his cart and went to sleep. Tell me that he didn't have something to do with that. Law enforcement still did not respond. By the way, I was on Grand Avenue at the 430 North Rush little sidewalk next to the Divvy bikes. I could see law enforcement less than a block away, lights on. I called 911 three times, spoke with dispatch two times. How come it's possible that when we're 7 years old and we get curious about 911 and call 911, the fire department, four squad cars, backup, they all show up within seconds? But as a grown-up, single woman, mother of three, soon to be four, with no criminal record, no mental health history, and no drug abuse history, I can be blatantly ignored by law enforcement. Does anyone want to make that one make sense for me? Because I'm very curious. This is one of the richest zip codes in the state of Illinois. 60611, right? So as a tax-paying citizen who's been paying taxes since she was 14 fucking years old, you would expect that if you call the police for assistance, they show up, right? If your argument is that police don't come to the hood, or that police don't come if you don't work a full-time job or you're not in a certain tax bracket, what's the reasoning for them not responding to me being beaten up by two grown-up men? If the government has not been taken over, at the very least locally, make sense of that, please. I dare you. You can't. 2019 is when this abuse began, and we're in 2023. My children were not in high school when this began. My oldest graduates this year. In the 4 years, my vehicle, a Cadillac CTS that I paid for in full by myself, with the exception of $800 for a down payment that I borrowed. Again, let me stress that again. I paid for the entire car by myself, on my own. My vehicle. Made my last payment, and within 30 days of doing so, I was followed to a gated community in Barrington where I was supposed to be safe, and the car was keyed and mechanically sabotaged. I paid about $2,000 in total over the next 3 months to fix everything that they would do. They would follow me from address to address, from location to location. They would pour liquid in the wrong little containers, like water pump fluid, or I don't know what the fluids are called, but they would put like windshield washer stuff in the gas tank. They would put grody, like sawdust type stuff in the oil area. I was so on top of getting my oil changed. I love that car like a baby. It was one of the last safe spaces I had in the world after being unlawfully displaced in 2019 following Dylan beating the fuck out of me. losing everything I own, my clothes, my children's clothes, our home, everything, literally. But they destroyed that too. They destroyed my vehicle as well. Like I said a million times, there's a specific following that is not disgusting, slanderous, committing felony, domestic terrorism, and libel. Every once in a while, I think that they get blocked completely from any of the things that are going on, and all that I'm left with are the criminals, con artists, fraud people, thieves, none of which have I ever been. As a matter of fact, I went 5 whole days once without eating anything and collapsed from exhaustion and a lack of food before I ever even considered walking into a grocery store and taking a protein bar. I don't know what it's going to take, if my children are going to have to bury me for this to stop, or what, but it's terrifying and it's really exhausting. And I promise you that my contribution to society should and could be much greater than being attacked while I'm sleeping over and over again, being raped, being robbed, being beaten, being robbed again, being raped again, being beaten again. I know that for a fact. I know how to do website, copyright, website build-outs, new business development, e-commerce, marketing, social media management. As you can see here, I've successfully grown about 7 pages. While all of this other raping and robbing and beating have been going on, I've successfully organically grown 7 other pages to the thousands, tens of thousands, 16,000, 39,000, with no issue. Oh. Look, they don't miss their coffee, but for a woman getting beat up by 2 middle-aged black men, they're nowhere to be found. Isn't that interesting? A pregnant woman on top of it. I'm being denied medical. I'm being denied a lawyer. I'm being beaten. I'm being raped. And I'm being robbed on a semi-regular basis. And I have to call my children and smile to them and pretend like the only thing wrong is that I don't have my apartment back yet. Do you think that small children can handle hearing that their mother is being raped in cold blood in the street and that society walks by in the hundreds of people walk by each day, hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands watch my lives and my stories. No one has done anything, nothing. Xavier's father gave him $100 to repay me towards the thousands that I spent on Airbnb for us last winter. He gave him the $100 payment. I believe it was $200. Xavier lied to me, kept the money, went and spent it elsewhere and gave me $50. And then I had to spend 20 of the 50 on breakfast for him the next morning. So I got $30 from the $200 payment that was supposed to be for my youngest child's birthday gift. Her birthday is this week. Overall, I've asked him now probably 300, maybe more times to stop abusing me sexually, verbally, financially, and otherwise, or get away from me. He has repeatedly refused, on camera and off. He has repeatedly, in front of law enforcement, refused. As recently as last week, in front of St. James Cathedral, I called law enforcement when he, again, was being incredibly abusive, refusing to leave. And I was bullied by the officers, and I use the term loosely, that responded. A woman who looked like she was probably born a man, really thick eyebrows, a really offensive odor, standing over me like... If I'm sitting, I was sitting down on the steps and she came and like hovered over me and was incredibly intimidating. What's the fucking problem, ma'am? I'm not used to dealing with people nor being dealt with like that. Unless I'm actively being beaten up, you can pretty much rest assured knowing I would never approach you that way. And being actively beaten up can mean a number of things. Either I'm being physically assaulted, sexually assaulted, or verbally assaulted, right? And we all have a threshold, as we know. And mine was met 4, 5, 10, 6 years ago. So in addition to having all of my personal safety measures stolen from me, my knives. So I've had two knives stolen from me, a Smith & Wesson, as well as just a regular $20 pocket knife from Walmart. Both of them have been stolen. Courtney Bell sold me another knife for $40 cash, just a pocket knife. They're all street legal. They all follow the same laws. Someone stole that one as well. So that's three knives in the last year that have been stolen from me. So that's a grand total of about $100. $800 cash that's been stolen from me. Probably about $200 or $300 of Link card money stolen directly off my card, usually while I'm asleep. And then I'm also being incredibly restricted in communication with my entire family. I haven't spoken with my mother in close to a year and a half. And I don't think I've spoken with my actual real father in about the same. They do have really cheap imitations of both. So they're using software that's actually relatively cheap. It's AI software. You can Google it if you're in the dark with regards to tech. What does Bill Proctor say from the Law of Attraction? We don't have to understand it to know its worth and it's real. We don't understand electricity, but that doesn't stop us from going and flipping on the light switch every morning, right? So the things I'm explaining to you, if you are ignorant enough to not understand them, don't be ignorant enough to assume that they're not real. Again, we don't know how electricity works, but we do know that when we go and flip on the light switch, the lights will turn on, right? It's the same concept. I don't know how law enforcement has not responded, how this is legal, how this is ethical, but it's happening. It's most certainly happening, and it's happening over and over and over, and it needs to stop. And if you're not concerned, like I've said about 100,000 times, why don't you do us a favor and pretend like it's someone you love? Your wife, your pregnant wife, your mom. I'm a mom. I'm someone's mom. Someone watches these lives and thinks, God, I hope my mom's going to be okay. I'm also a business person. So when we talk about new business development, my background is formally in new business development in the sector of healthcare, medical law and ethics to be specific and precise. I've gone to about 7 schools. I've gone to community college, College of DuPage, Triton College. I also transferred to a 4-year university, American Intercontinental University. I graduated high school a year early before the rest of my class. What a shame that the society we live in can listen to the rhetoric that I'm explaining and send pictures of a tooth in the comments. A woman is crying on a live feed, pregnant, because she's being sexually assaulted and robbed, and you're in the comments sending teeth emojis. What's your value? Do you think that you deserve to live? Do you think that you deserve maybe to be raped in the street and call law enforcement for help and have them not respond? I mean, I don't know. I'm asking, what do you think you deserve? You're stalking a woman who wants nothing from you and who wants you to get out of her comments. I have 900 people on my blocked list since coming out in a 6-episode series of a reality show, Love After Lockup. 6 episodes, I can't remember. And 900 people have needed to be blocked for calling me obscene names. Well, the good news is there are about 40,000 following my accounts who are supportive. There are about double that who have donated, who have expressed interest in helping. So for those of you who are so lacking in self-esteem that you continue to badger, bully, and provoke a pregnant woman who's been victimized sexually, financially, verbally, mentally, every way you can imagine, be careful, because that shit does come back. If you don't want to think about me, if you don't want to think that it's possible for an innocent woman to be raped in the street for going on 4 years, reporting every single step of the way without receiving any assistance, why don't you consider the effect and the impact that it's had on my innocent children, or my mother, or my father, or my grandparents, or anyone in my family who didn't come out on a reality show, had no say-so in anything that was going on, and still don't, and how they're being negatively impacted. I've said it before and I'll say it again, everyone who continues to slander in the comments is on board. This is premeditated. I want them all charged. These are not cyber crimes anymore. We've hit the 4-year mark, so they know what it is. They know that they're intentionally slandering and libeling so that I have problems getting business. In addition to new business development, creating websites, landing pages, I also, as I said, have a formal background in healthcare administration, law, and ethics. I single-handedly assisted numerous, up to 30 doctors with the EMR implementation for their practices at Northwestern Hospital. And I have numerous, I mean, many, many, many letters of recommendation from physicians, all the way down to the janitorial staff who will say I am kind and caring and compassionate and smart and an excellent candidate for any endeavor that I set my mind to. Being raped is never something that I said I wanted to do, so it'd be great if I could get a different fucking opportunity. I want to press charges. Again, I've said it about 30 times. I want to press charges against everyone involved. I want them all charged to the fullest extent of the law. If you guys see last week, I was approached by another woman in person. I went to the dollar store. I've been trying to think of outside the box services that I can offer for money since I'm being stalked, gang stalked into the last 30 jobs that I've obtained legally. So I've gotten waitressing jobs, I've gotten secretarial jobs, I got a job doing roofing replacement sales and translations for that company. Everything was written in Spanish to English to English to Spanish. You know, and every single opportunity within the first 2 weeks, I'm literally chased and bullied out. Someone who claims they're an investigator or a detective calls my work and says that I'm involved in something nefarious, or at least that's what the employers say. I don't do anything. Do you guys think that if I was doing something nefarious, I'd be sleeping outside in a fucking tent getting physically assaulted throughout the night? Probably not, right? I don't know what else to say. I can't take it anymore. There's nothing wrong with me. I'm intelligent, probably smarter than most of you. And I'm not saying that in a cocky way. I'm saying that because, unfortunately for me, my following is a lot of like redneck, ghetto as fuck. A lot of people who watch that show, Love After Lockup, I had never even heard of that show when Dylan worked his deal with the state of Illinois. They're so nefarious. They're so crooked. And they looked at this man doing time for a Class X felony, kidnapping a woman. They helped him hide his record and then watched while he did the same thing to me that he did to Marissa, Jordan Lott, Star, her name is Estrella on Instagram. Who else? Jessica had to be moved out of state to California because he was pimping her in the streets. Samantha, he got addicted to heroin. Not my sister, Samantha. Samantha, his first girlfriend. So you found a show and whoever works for the state of Illinois at the time, and they decided to offer Dylan, who, again, has been breaking women for his entire adult life, on record. And you guys put him on a reality show to stroke his ego. And now you're curious about why the innocent woman in the background is getting raped, beaten, robbed, abused, and cast out and left outside. It will never make sense to me because, as I said last time, a judge ruled the contract between Love After Lockup and anyone who signed it unconscionable. Unconscionable, meaning it does not hold up in court. How is the show still playing episodes? How are they still netting profit? How many of their characters have overdosed in the months following filming? How many of them have been beaten physically? Look at my eye. It's still this. I was bludgeoned with a tire iron. I was jumped by three women and stabbed 11 times with screwdrivers. Do you know how many times I've been violently attacked prior to Dylan's release? Not a single time. None. So I've never been attacked. Then Dylan comes out of prison and I'm beaten, raped, robbed, abused. The bludgeoning is posted here. Multiple of the assaults where I'm being followed down the street in a vehicle that someone rented that's the same as mine. I posted video of that. I posted video of the fake law enforcement, Gog of Magog is what I've been referring to them as. Jehovah's Witnesses go around preaching about this evil police force that takes over when the real police are just not doing their job. And that's the mark of the end of the world and the mark of the beast. And they call them God of Magog. And these police don't care about anything. And they come around assaulting women and, you know, raping women and children and stealing and kidnapping people. And that's, I'm convinced, what's going on. I have full-length live video of myself driving down the street in Westchester being pursued by six fake cops, all in plain clothes, all in cars with no markings on the side. I also have live video of me when I was staying in Lombard at Andy's house, a person I didn't even know. I just met him because when I was working promotions with Open Road Radio with Gina, she had a mechanic named Andy. And since these people started defiling my vehicle, pouring shit in all of the gas pumps and things of this nature, she put me in contact with this Andy the mechanic. Andy the mechanic started helping me fix my car. Well, he had a big house in Villa Park, and he said, I have three extra bedrooms. If you need somewhere to stay while you get on your feet, you could stay here. He knew I liked to work out. He lived right across the street from LA Fitness. On a live camera, no one knows that I'm at his house. No one. Okay, I was there less than a week. The same morning, I wake up and go to Dunkin' Donuts and come back. Law enforcement is calling me through Andy's phone saying, you need to tell Heather to come out of the house. How does Andy and law enforcement have each other's phone numbers? How do they know that's Andy's house? Why am I being pursued by another round of fake cops in Lombard? Make it make sense. Make it make sense. Yet I'm never arrested. All these false claims about me are true, yet I've never been prosecuted. Give me a fucking break. I'm tired of this. On top of that, at Andy's house, I woke up and my bikini bottom was off. I asked Andy about it. To be honest, I thought that he was low-key. So I didn't really think it was him. But what they've been doing is they've been using a lot of gay men to commit rape against straight women. They either rape the men or sexually extort or financially extort the men into silence. And I believe that's what they did. I believe they introduced me to Andy on purpose, that they knew that he was going to, you know, leave his door open and let people have access to me, and that that's what they did. And after those two fake encounters, or real encounters, they were real on my behalf. I don't know those people. I was definitely being chased. An older black gentleman had to, driving a Suburban. Now, mind you, when they chased me in Westchester, this Gog of Magog, the police in Westchester, I called dispatch. And I said, I was pulled over and I stopped. I'm parked on the shoulder. This officer is asking me to get out of the car, and that's not what happens on a traffic stop, right? First, he's trying to motion me into a dark alley. Then he's motioning me out of the car. So I call dispatch and say, I don't believe this is a real officer, and I'm on a live stream. I had two phones at the time. And on a live stream, dispatch says, we can't confirm nor can we deny that those are real officers. I took off. They followed me through Westchester. These are Westchester police following me through Westchester, Maywood, not Bellwood, the other one that starts with a B, not Bolingbrook, what is that one called? Right by Roosevelt and 25th. just east of Westchester. It starts with a B, Broadview. Broadview, Westchester, and Maywood. If you're the police, you don't have jurisdiction. If you're what, because they claim to be Westchester police. On the official police report that I have a copy of, they later say that they were Westchester police, that they no longer are with the practice. Okay. Or with the station. Yeah. All right. An older black man with a Suburban, and this is also on camera, he cuts them off, allowing me the opportunity to get away and get onto the expressway and flee to Chicago. I've never been so terrified in my life. This has been going on since 2019. Again, I want to remind you, prior to 2019, the most excitement I ever had was if someone tried to hurt me on the job. So if I was dancing, and I always had security with me, you know, if you go to a strip club, there are bouncers, right? Well, I never actually got attacked, you know, in that way while dancing, but I definitely got hurt in other capacities where security didn't have an opportunity to intervene. With the exception of those half occurrences, all I did Monday through Thursday, I stayed in the house with my children. I didn't even go outside unless it was to pick them up. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, I filled my day with work. I worked from the fucking moment I opened my eyes. Sometimes I didn't even sleep until the time I had to pick up my children. The literal most excitement I ever had was if someone attacked me during that time, which happened, I think, 3 times. And I had security, so I was safe, but it fucked me up. Now, I escaped that fucking scenario where the feds were in my ear the whole time. Don't get it twisted. My phone calls have been being recorded since 2015, and I'm aware of that. I actually went in front of Internal Affairs Department in 2015 and 16 with my lawyer, Nick Albuquerque, because of the way law enforcement was dealing with me, because they didn't like Dylan. I'm from the west suburbs. I've never been in a fist fight in my entire life, but I'm being followed, raped, beaten, assaulted, stabbed, stolen from. Make it make sense. Please make it make sense. So again, this is another round of documentation. This is Heather Gillespie. These are my prenatal vitamins, just to prove that I am who I say I am. Here's my tattoo. I have one behind my ear. I am being followed and abused again. And I am not fucking for it. And I have called law enforcement again, another 3 times, and been blatantly ignored again. I am 5 months pregnant. I am concerned for the well-being of my big kids, who are in school already, as well as my unborn child. Something about 3 o'clock in the morning being kicked in the fucking face from being asleep, that just rubs you the wrong way and makes you feel like you can't trust the world. In addition to that, like I said, I have now asked Xavier to stop following me a number of times. He stole my tent, the one that these people broke. I wish that you could have seen it from my perspective. I don't know if you've ever been woken up to someone breaking into your home. When it's a house and you're protected by brick and mortar, it's scary. When it's a tent and there's not a goddamn thing other than a piece of nylon protecting you from 2 grown men, it's terrifying. Like I said, I curled into the fetal position trying to protect my unborn baby. Xavier did nothing. And I've asked him to leave about 30 times. Multiple witnesses, 430 North Rush is the location. I don't want him near me. I don't want any of these people following me. I've not given my permission for any of them to follow me. I owe none of them money or time or attention or anything. I don't owe anyone shit at all. Nothing. I feel as though I'm existing in a space where there's no requirement for self-control. I feel as though this environment is conducive to abuse. They are urging people. They are baiting people. They are setting people up to be abusive. What do I mean by that? Let me give you a perfect example. So as I said to you, you know that I've survived numerous counts of sexual abuse and trauma. In doing so, you're welcome. In doing so, I've shared with Xavier that I have a lot of unresolved business when it comes to sex in general. I don't like it. I could go the rest of my life never having it again and lead a perfectly happy, fulfilled life. When I love someone, I can enjoy it, but it's not something that I'm seeking, right? When we're living in a state of lack, anything that we're lacking, money, love, whatever, we're seeking, whether we intend to seek or not, we are seeking. So when we're out, when we're in conversation with people, we're looking for the validation of the missing piece. Again, if it's love, it's love. If it's affection, it's affection. If it's money, it's money. We're in a state of seeking. We're living in a state of lack. I've been living in a state of lack with regards to love, but not sex, love. So Xavier being the person who spent every day, you know, for the past 15 months next to me, him knowing this, it gives him the upper hand when it comes to abusing me. And it's not just him. Dylan did the exact same thing. The person closest to you, the person who knows your traumas, your triggers, and your weaknesses better than anyone else, is always going to be in an upper hand to cause you harm. But what does that mean? Do we go through the rest of our lives, even be in committed monogamous relationships, fearful of sharing our traumas, fearful of being, you know, vulnerable, honest? There have to be safe people and safe spaces for us to continue evolving. If you're trapped, it's like energy, it's like water, it's like anything. It needs to flow, right? When you turn on the faucet, if there's no flow, what happens? A flood happens, right? There's too much water and now it's overflowing and destroying everything around it. Emotions are the same. Energy is the same. Trauma is the same. So if you have a demographic of people and you're not allowing their traumas to process, there's a blockage. There's a blockage of energy. And what happens when you have too much blocked? We try not to judge and call things positive or negative, but for lack of a better term, let's call it difficult energy. When you have too much blocked and trapped difficult energy, it overflows. It destroys everything around you. So that's kind of the update. Chicago police have again been incredibly disappointing to deal with. I try so hard to defend you guys. I swear I do. I have gotten into so many, really heated debates about the police, about underserved communities, about racism, about hatred, about all sorts of shit, okay? And I'm not talking about just regular racism like, you know, that we're used to dealing with. I'm talking about extortion racism, like immigrants coming over here without papers and being pulled over, and rather than the law saying, okay, look, you were doing 2 miles over the limit, I understand you're late to work and you work for below minimum wage, I'm gonna throw you a bone here, they'll say something like, follow me, we're going to your bank, you're gonna empty your bank account, or I'm gonna take you to prison and deport you. This is the type of racist, and that's not the only type, there's several types, but more so than racist policing is political policing, where they get their finger on someone that is trapped, who's literally having their neck stepped on because they don't have papers, because they don't speak the language, because they don't have advocacy. And they take advantage. And like I said before, I have stood up for law enforcement so many times. There was this whole movement, Back the Blue. How can I believe in a group of people who don't come when I call 911? How can I trust a badge that literally says protect and serve on it when they've left an entire section of people exposed, unprotected, and unserved. I can't. So I'm not saying I hate the police, and I'm not even NWA-ing it. I'm just saying I can't stand up for you guys anymore if every time I'm being violently assaulted, you're a no-show. I mean, is that not fair? In addition to that, if you guys go to my live from a week ago, you can see I called the FBI local field office right here on Roosevelt Road. That's the same field office I've been using to report. And I'm not an informant. I have no cases. I have no criminal record. I've never been involved in a criminal investigation before. But I know people who have. So I tried calling this field office when I stopped getting responses from CPD. If I have police reports on file for being raped since 2016-17 time, and I call and a detective answers and I say, hey, where are we in this case? Has any progress been made? Have you guys even compared notes with the other towns? And the detectives respond, no, we don't know. How can I have faith in your organization? I cannot, is the answer. So I just like to leave that completely out from now on. If you're going to continue to throw me into positions and take away my weapons for self-protection, and also take away the ability to call law enforcement if I'm being assaulted, this is very realistically Gog Magog. This is a scorched earth scenario. There is no, you know, there is no legislation, there is no order, law, justice, any of that. And if there is, I welcome you to point me in its direction. Because as I said, this has been going on for me since early 2015 or 16. I've been separated from my three children, who I've raised since their days of birth, respectively, since January of 2020. Separated meaning we don't live together, but I still to this day see them whenever, you know. May 16th, I went to take my youngest to the park. Her father said, she's got a dance recital coming up, can you go? I said, of course I'll be there, I never miss it. 2 days later, he called me on the phone, and it's the same situation I explained to you guys. It's the voice of my father, it's the voice of her father, it's not the cadence, it's not the dialect, and it's not the vibe. So it feels as though someone has auto-tuned their voices, but is using another person to communicate, and the things they say are not real. As I've said to you guys a million times, I am very blessed to have a father who, even though he has barely no money, lives in a tiny apartment, cannot support me and is physically disabled, he would never say, you can't live here. If my father, and I've said this before, if my father lived in a fucking refrigerator box on the side of the road, he'd be like, there's a room for you here. You know, wherever I am, you can be. That's my father. That's a real parent. And I've been very blessed, you know, to have that kind of love in my life. My father hasn't said that to me. My father said the opposite. You can't come here. My father would never hear my words. He would never, ever. So I want to leave it at that because there are people doing meetings here. It was quiet until now. I don't want to monopolize the airspace, but it needed to be said and it needed to be documented. And again, if there's anything you guys can do to help, if there are any resources that you're aware of, any programs, career placement, like I said, besides marketing, social media management, small business development, healthcare administration, I have a bachelor's degree, I have a fitness background, fitness and nutrition, any kind of work you guys have. And that's what I was bringing up also. I've been watching a lot of these DIYs from the dollar store. So if you'd like to have your door front decorated for Halloween, I can do so for $100, an entire door front. And that's the walkway, the supplies, the labor, and the work. And that's what I was doing at the dollar store last week when that woman came up behind me and Xavier and was playing my voice on audio. I filed a police report and she goes, yeah, you're being followed, you're being stalked. And I said, who are you? And she said, I just wanted you to know that you are being followed. And Xavier goes, do you work for Google? And she goes, no, I don't work for Google, but she's definitely being followed. So, you know, it's a bunch of really ignorant behaviors that are incredibly predatory and that I can't, explain. So it is terrifying. But you guys all have a great day. Thank you for listening. If you've made it this entire time, I owe you $5. As painful as it is for you to hear, it's equally as painful for you to say. Xavier did steal the payment that his father gave me, so if anyone wants to send anything, please use the Cash App. It's $HeatherGoProSolo. Again, the money will be being used to replace the MySpace to sleep, so a tent, a birthday gift for my daughter, glasses, a couple other things that I need to pay. And that I'm owed. This is not money that I'm asking or begging for. Xavier's father agreed to repay me for the thousands of dollars I spent putting his son inside of an Airbnb and feeding and taking care of his son for 2 months. Cash App. Thank you guys so much. I hope everyone has a great day. And if there's anything going on in your city, if your law enforcement is being unresponsive, if there are groups of people dedicated to targeting and slandering the innocent, please point them out, because I have an entire team who's ready to not only charge, but also apprehend.